So I should really introduce myself before I get too much into this. So who's this guy blabbing here? So my name's Kyle Tainter. I'm a senior aviculturist here at the International Crane Foundation. And I have been here full time since, it's hard to imagine, but it was actually Valentine's Day, 2012. I was actually an intern right out of college before that. They're crazy enough to hire me back, and I'm still here and I'm loving it. And I truly enjoy my job every day, and really every day is different. There's always something new to look forward to, and it's truly just a great place to work with great people, and truly just love it. So the picture you're looking at here, many of you may have seen this. So this is actually Crane City. You probably have not quite seen it from this view, at least I hope you have not, because this is actually a picture taken from atop our food cooler. So you definitely should not have been up there, but this is kind of an overarching look of Crane City. Really the only time folks other than ourselves are out there is during our members day. So then you kind of get a little behind the scenes tour, if you will. A lot of times if you've gone to that, I've talked about AI, which I'll get into a little bit in depth later, but this is Crane City. So I work in the Crane Conservation Department, and if I reference CCD later on, that's just what that stands for. We have 6 full-time staff. Like I said, myself, our curator of birds, Kim Boardman, who is on the call with us here, our assistant curator, and then we have 3 other aviculture staff. And we rely heavily upon interns. Depending on the time of year, get anywhere from 3 to 8 interns, whether it's our kind of our fall, winter, you know, not so busy season versus our spring, summer season when we're, you know, doing all sorts of things. We really rely heavily on interns, and they're a great, great help and a great part of our team. A lot of you probably, hopefully, have been to visit our site here. I really encourage you to come visit now soon when we open up, because it's the difference in the last couple of years is just tremendous. And my staff, you know, us within CCD, we do work with the birds up on exhibit. Really, a lot of our focus is out here in Crane City, kind of the behind the scenes, if you will. So a lot of our behind the scenes stuff really happens up there. We have roughly 80 birds out in Crane City, and we have, you know, another 25 to 30 birds on average on exhibit. So over 100 birds on site here. So we're working directly with these birds every day, everything related to the captive management up now. So really, it goes from everything from just the daily husbandry. So I actually grew up on a dairy. Not to go too far on a tangent here, but I actually grew up on a dairy farm here in rural Wisconsin. And it really is very similar to that. You can imagine there's a few differences between, you know, a 1,000-pound Jersey cow and a 15-pound whooping crane. But really, you know, the feeding, the watering, the keeping enclosures clean, a lot of it really is the same. So for me, going from living on a farm to this really wasn't too much of a transition. Other than the weird odds and ends that you can imagine, but so yeah, we have the daily husbandry, taking care of our captive flock, making sure their welfare is good, and here you can see a slide. This slide on the left side of your screen is actually artificial insemination, which I'm not going to get to in too detail right now, because you can imagine that will happen later. But along with, you know, our staff within the CCD, we also work very closely with our conservation medicine team, our vet, Dr. Barry Hartup, and our vet tech, Sue Lakin, just to make sure, you know, our captive cranes are well cared for. We're doing annual health checks, just making sure our birds are in good healthy conditions. Also, you know, this is probably pretty much, I would say, most of our staff's favorite, obviously working with chicks. So before chicks come, obviously we have AI, artificial insemination, we have incubation, eggs, everything related to that. And then the end result, a lot of the times, is this. So we have, you know, our whooping crane chicks, which is a heavy focus of ours. We also work with several different species. So that's pretty much the end goal here is, you know, and everybody who doesn't love seeing cute chicks, even myself, even though I try not to get so cutesy about that. Anyway, so here we are, the meat and potatoes, which you guys came for. So the title slide here, AI and cranes, and I don't mean C-3PO or R2-D2 cranes. The only reason I mentioned that is I personally think a lot of people, when they hear the acronym AI, they kind of automatically go to artificial intelligence, you know, Star Wars. And before I go too far into that, please, no questions regarding Star Wars, because I will not be able to answer those properly. So don't get mad at me for that. I just thought it was kind of a funny, catchy title. But really what this is about is artificial insemination at the International Crane Foundation. And one last personal memory lane, we'll call it here, for me, is I've actually had an interest in AI, artificial insemination, since honestly as long as I can remember. My grandpa Tainer actually, for a living, bred cows. So he grew up, you know, in rural La Crosse area. I don't know if you guys are familiar with the area. So he actually inseminated cattle for a living, as long as running his own dairy farm. And he's, in his lifetime, he's actually artificially inseminated over 100,000 cattle, which is incredible. So I know the first time that I actually participated in AI here at the Crane Foundation, I was just absolutely amazed, and it was very intriguing to me. And honestly, that same night, I called my grandpa and told him, hey, Grandpa, guess what? I was more yelling through the phone because, well, he's old. I said, Grandpa, guess what I did today? And he's, huh? What? I said, Grandpa, I artificially inseminated a crane today. And honestly, like through the phone, I honestly feel like I could see his eyes light up. So it was a really cool experience for me to be able to, you know, talk to him about that. And even now to this day, I'm lucky enough to have my grandpa around that will talk about AI. And, you know, as you can imagine, artificially inseminating 1,000-pound Jersey cow is quite different than, you know, a 15-pound whipping crane, but really there are a lot of similarities, and really you're looking at the same end result. So it's just kind of a background for me, a little tangent I went on there. So why do we perform AI? Why not just let these birds naturally copulate on their own? The short answer is sometimes we do let them naturally copulate. Not often, honestly. And like I discussed before, whooping cranes is, you know, kind of one of our big main focuses. And as you can imagine, you know, in the mid 20th century, the population of whooping cranes became down to such a genetic bottleneck that even to this day, we're just basically trying to diversify these genetics out as much as we can. So that's one of the big reasons. And we often don't actually pair new birds together, a male and a female, based upon genetics, because that can change over time, whether, you know, a certain individual's offsprings, they're overrepresented in the wild or captivity, where there's a lot of those, but there's not a lot of these other individuals. It can change over time. So really, when we're pairing birds, it's not based upon genetics. It's more, and these cranes are a lot like people, honestly. Their individual characteristics, their personalities. So a lot of times what we're doing is just trying to get them paired together, get them, you know, liking each other, loving each other enough that get them into breeding mode. And then from there, we can diversify the genetics and we can kind of go from there. Also, another reason for why we do AI is fertility. So we can just get, most of the time, you know, we can just get increased fertility. And as you can imagine, every single whooping crane, I mean, every egg matters, but really every single whooping crane egg matters as far as fertility. We're trying to get as many as we can. So we're just trying to up our fertility as much as we can there. Physical problems, you know, we have lots and lots of birds here, and we do such a good job. And I don't want to toot our own horn here too much, but we do such a good job of taking care of them that they often live to be quite old. And a lot of times they'll, you know, the older they get, you know, just like humans, they have arthritis, they have issues where they physically can't actually naturally copulate together. So that's where we can come in, and, you know, we might have a 40-year-old male whooping crane that we're still collecting semen on, even though physically he can't copulate himself. Another reason here is behavioral problems. So we have, you know, sometimes we'll get birds in from different facilities where they're actually imprinted. So they actually will never pair with another bird just because they're imprinted on people. So obviously, if they're never paired with a bird, they never can naturally copulate. So that's where we come in again. We can collect from these birds and inseminate the female and whatever it may be. And then something I don't have written here is a lot of, you know, SSPs, so species survival plans. So we get requests from other facilities, you know, hey, we want you to artificially inseminate this particular female with this male and such and such. And then a lot of it is just, you know, science and research. We're trying to further the, you know, the cryopreservation, which is something we're actually going to get into a little bit more now. Trying to basically make that as viable as possible. So that's something I'm really looking forward to, something I really haven't done a lot of. So a lot of it's just, you know, science and research behind it as well. So let's see, when to perform AI. So this is a very loaded question, if you will. So we keep very, very, very detailed records here at ICF. Some of our female birds, we have egg records that date back 20 plus years. So, you know, each particular year, when did this bird lay its first egg? When did it lay its last egg? You know, how many days in between clutches, stuff like that. And a lot of it, a bird laying an egg is based upon photo period. So the amount of daylight is basically what it comes down to. There are various things that can affect that year to year. Weather sometimes might delay things a week or so. You know, in Wisconsin, you can imagine the kind of weather we can have here in spring. But it really does really factor into it quite a bit. And then the timing. I hope you guys can see this this little calendar here I have. But this is basically what I call, you know, my first AI date. So I have a bunch of different female names on here, and basically I'm putting them down. I believe this would be for the month of April. I don't think I have that in there. But basically I get this calendar started at the beginning of the year, and looking back at all that history of when birds tend to lay, I try and get a potential start date, basically, of when to start AI on them. So I have that there as a, and you know, like I said, with weather, different factors that may get skewed a week later, a week earlier, whatever it may be. But this is kind of a good general start line we have to get going. And then another thing is just egg formation, which I'll get into a little bit more later. So not only the timing of the year, you know, March, April, May, whatever it may be, but also the timing of how long it actually takes an egg to go from fertilization to hatching, laying. So that's another thing, and I will get into that a little bit later. And kind of related to the historical egg records we have, as you can see here in this picture, we have a pair of wattle cranes on the left and a pair of saros cranes on the right. It's pretty common for our wattle cranes to start nest building, nest searching, and laying eggs in February, as early as February. And then you have kind of the other end of the spectrum here, where saros cranes tend to lay usually not till June, if not July. So, you know, there's quite a bit of time difference in between those. And then most of our other species are kind of right in the middle. So we're looking at April and May, I would say, you know, are really two really busy months as far as artificial insemination and eggs and all that goes, your whooping cranes are sized, pretty much everyone is kind of in between those. But then even within the same species, we have, for example, Achilles, who is a female whooping crane here at ICF, she usually lays her first egg probably in, gosh, it's hard to imagine, but probably in about 3 weeks here, the end of March, very early April. We have other whooping crane females, Josh, for example, and, you know, I won't be surprised if she doesn't lay her first egg until mid-May. So we're talking, you know, 5-6 weeks of difference, and it's very consistent from year to year too. So we have a general idea of when they're actually going to lay, and kind of spreads the season out. It's kind of like I like to tell people, it's like a standard bell curve, really, where we'll have a few birds early, then, you know, slowly increasing until you reach the peak. Then you get down towards the, you know, the end of May where it starts going back down. So we might start AI the first couple of weeks of just doing a few birds, and then by the top of that bell curve, it's just going crazy and hard to keep up some days. But yeah, that's, it really is. And then one of the hardest parts too, and I feel like I remember, perhaps I took a genetics class in college, but it's been a while. So basically, a lot of folks are probably wondering, how do you determine which birds to pair together as far as artificial insemination? And honestly, I don't do that. We have a geneticist that actually goes through and looks at, you know, mean kinship and different values of these birds. And then basically they tell you that, you know, this male that you have needs to be paired with this female, and the list goes on. I said, okay, that's great. Sometimes it can be difficult because, you know, like the birds I mentioned earlier, Achilles, you know, one of the donors for her may be paired with a different female who doesn't lay eggs for another 5-6 weeks. So, and that male that's paired, physically paired with that female, they know when they should be producing sperm, basically. So sometimes it can get difficult when you have, you know, certain pairs that need to go together, and the timing is just off a little. So it gets interesting. You know, I like to have a good plan ahead of time, but then I have a plan B, a plan C, a plan D. So it really depends on year to year, day to day, but that's what keeps it fun, right? So yeah, like I said, I get this big plan together, and then we have this awesome new video system, which we can keep track of birds right by our computers now. So we have to thank all our donors for that too. That's incredible. It honestly makes our lives so much easier. But yeah, we have this video system where we can do recordings. We can watch birds live, basically Big Brother, spy on them. A lot of times we'll do it with, you know, birds that are raising chicks, stuff like that. But we also can, you know, if I don't plan on doing, for example, artificial insemination on Achilles, that whooping crane, until the first week in April, and I'm watching video of her and her mate, and she's soliciting and she's pre-cop calling, you know, 2 weeks before that, you know, yeah, my calendar says this day, but the birds are telling me that, you know, we need to start now. So the video system really is incredibly helpful for us to get a really better idea and really narrow it down to a specific time frame. So the tools of the trade, as I call it, and I probably left out one of the most important tools of the trade, which are our actual staff. But really, these are, you know, these honestly are, it's pretty, I don't want to say simple, but I mean, we're not using super fancy equipment here, as you can tell. Shot glasses, syringes, semen extender, which is basically, you know, to put it bluntly, it's kind of a sugar water, if you will. Basically, all it's doing is extending the life of the semen. Sometimes we might collect from a male at 8 o'clock in the morning, and the way we're going through AI through Crane City, that sample might not go to the female for another hour. So basically, you know, I'll talk a little bit more about that later on as well. But we're just trying to extend that life of the semen as much as possible. And this last picture here on the right is one of our female wild cranes, Katsa. And I just took this picture super recently. I opened the gate and she's an imprinted bird, so she just immediately began soliciting me. So yeah, we have our shot glasses, syringes, our semen extender. But really, I mean, when it comes down to it, the birds are quite obviously the most important. So, okay, here we go. Here's a shameless plug that I'm going to throw in. So this is a picture on the left of my beautiful wife and my beautiful dogs, and then just me. The only reason I'm throwing this in there, because to me, AI starts way, way earlier than, you know, April, May, whatever it may be. So basically, my wife and I, every year, we like to go out to a Christmas tree farm, and sustainable, of course, go out and hunt down our perfect tree. And as we're walking through, you know, she's looking for, oh, will that fit in our house, this and that, and, you know, see, well, she's going to know, because I'm pretty sure she might be watching this. Well, she's on to my secrets now. But as we're going through, I'm also looking at the tree thinking, will that work well as a capture corner? Is that one going to fall apart? Is it too big? Is it too small? So for me, honestly, the thought of AI starts, you know, first or second week of December. And then, you know, also, I don't know if any of you guys live in Baraboo. Who knows? You might have seen me driving around through town with a truck and trailer right after the holidays, right after the new year, as I'm out driving around stealing trees that people put out for the city to collect. So if you ever see that, don't be alarmed. It's just me. Give a friendly wave. Not a big deal. I thought about putting on a Grinch costume and doing it to see if I could get any laughs, but I'd probably get called in as well. So I will not do that. But yeah, so for me, you know, it starts way earlier. And you guys may have seen at some point that, you know, especially on our social media pages, where if we're asking for, you know, tree donations, there's a reason for it. It's not that we just want to have a huge bonfire party at the end of the year or something. We actually do put them to use. And we use them as a capture corner, basically what it is. And this is why another reason, not only do you want to water your tree well to keep your house from possibly starting on fire, but you want to keep it watered well so that it stays nice and soft. Because we need them. We need them to be soft. And basically what we do, and there's, you know, the next slide will show it a little more. But basically we'll herd the birds into these capture corners, these old Christmas trees, and then we'll use it as a soft buffer versus if we were to herd them into their house. Depending on the bird, they might end up injuring themselves trying to get away from us with the hard walls. So the trees just work really well as a soft buffer. The birds kind of push against them. We can go in, grab them out. And so yes, please, if you ever see the need from us for Christmas trees, by all means, we will take anything and everything as long as you watered it well. That's all we will say about that. And certain trees work better, honestly. Spruce, balsam firs, pines are not my favorite. They tend to lose their leaves a little quicker. So if you're thinking about your tree for next year already and want to donate, I'll just throw those couple hints out there for you. Then we, you know, fast forward from, you know, January when we're putting up the capture corners to, you know, April, May, whatever it may be. The actual AI, so it has begun. It's really sneaking up on me here now in the next couple of weeks. It's hard to imagine. But as you can see here, our normal AI team consists of 3 people. We always try and do it first thing in the morning. Temperatures are cooler, so basically that, you know, not only helps to extend our semen after we collect it versus a hot, muggy day in the afternoon or whatever it may be. But honestly, birds tend to be a little more active in the morning too. So it's just, you know, they tend to respond better to artificial insemination early. And we'll pretty much go out every morning. We're on a schedule 3 days a week. And about the only time we might bypass the morning is if it's, you know, a heavy rain, something like that. You know, we don't want our potential sample to get contaminated with a bunch of rain or anything like that. But those nice sunny bluebird mornings are really honestly the best. But yeah, as you can see here, the trees, you know, they're a little, and it's amazing. I don't know what it is, but they'll actually retain their leaves quite well and stay, for lack of a better term, soft and act as a nice buffer for us, you know, well through the breeding season before we take them down. So team of three, we enter the yard. So we're always collecting from the male first, as you can imagine here. So we'll basically herd the birds into the corner here. Here is another example of a capture, which I honestly prefer. People think I'm crazy. But on the left here is a picture of a hooded crane giving a crouch threat. And then on the right is a picture of a Siberian crane giving a drop wing threat. So honestly, catching aggressive birds, not everyone will agree with me, but I think it's easier. It truly is, because they'll come after you. Most of the time, honestly, they'll come at you. You put your boot out and you grab them, and you know, you start getting into AI, and they actually settle down enough where they don't want to kill you anymore, for a while anyway. So honestly, it really depends on the bird, but there's honestly less chance of birds injuring themselves as well when they're aggressive, because they'll come at you. Sometimes we have a few birds that are, you know, a little more flighty that might go up into the capture corner and they'll literally almost like climb the trees and you got to pull them down. But, you know, we've been lucky enough and we're safe enough that we don't have any issues with that. So I just prefer this method. I know a lot of my staff that might be listening and I don't think I'm crazy, but oh well. So what do we got here? So actual AI, stroking and teasing. So basically what we're trying to do is simulate natural copulation. So with the males, and I know some of you have probably out in Crane City during Members Day have seen me try and sort of go through this. It's tough to do without a bird, but at least you have pictures here. So basically we're catching the bird up. The males, both the position's the same really for males and females. Their head is between our legs, so their head's facing back behind us. Their legs are out across from us here. And then basically what I'm doing, that's me in both pictures. So I'm the stroker in this case. So basically what I'm doing is rubbing the feathered portion of his thighs. And basically that's just simulating natural copulation. So if he were naturally copulating, he would be on top of the female. And you know, that part of his body would be, as he's up flapping around trying to maintain balance, would be getting stimulated. So that's basically what we're doing here. And then the picture on the right is the beginning process of the actual collection. So I think this one might give a little more. So basically what we have here then, picture on the left, again, you have the stroker, and then you have a teaser who's actually kind of teasing the cloaca out, if you will. Because when birds naturally copulate, they do what you call a cloacal kiss. So they're actually the male mounting the female. And I should have put a good picture in here, but I did not. Sorry about that. They actually do a cloacal kiss. Well, the male will be on top, mount the female, and as he's balancing, their cloacas will actually touch. And basically what the female do is she's everting her cloaca. And as his cloaca touch, she's basically, quite honestly, for lack of a better term, sucking all that up. So then, so that's basically what we're trying to stimulate here. And then we have the third person who is the collector with the actual shot glass. And honestly, there usually is not much sample there. But we're talking like a drop. It really varies from bird to bird, but just a drop. So basically, they're collecting the sample. As soon as they get the sample, we tell them, you know, get the heck out of the yard. That's, you know, that's what we came here for. That's the valuable stuff. If the birds happen to be aggressive, you know, you leave it to the other two people to worry about that. So they get the sample out. And then the picture on the right here is of Marianne Wellington. She's my, I'm like her young Padawan, if you will. That I do know from Star Wars. But she's basically taught me everything that I know about AI. So what she's doing here is she's drawing the sample up from the shot glass, and then we'll take detailed measurements of volume, how much is there. We make sure to always do this in the shade. You know, the sample is very light sensitive, UV sensitive. So we'll do it in the shade, and then what we'll also do is add the semen extender at this point. And the big thing after getting a collection is really to label that syringe. The last thing we want to do, you know, sometimes we might have 5 or 6 syringes with semen in them from different birds in our little toolbox at one time. And we just need to make sure they're labeled so we know which one belongs to which bird. And we never want to mess that up. So make sure that gets labeled at the end. So then, like I said, it might be an hour, half hour. It could be, it could be the same birds that are paired together that we're actually doing. They just can't naturally copulate. So finally, we do get to a female. Like I said, the capture is basically the same, herd them to the capture corner if they have one. We have, Cindy Gitter, our assistant curator on the left here. She is stroking a female bird. Positions the same, head through our legs, wings out. Basically what she's doing is actually kind of rubbing just above the tertiary feathers on a female, just kind of the lower back, if you will. And if a male were mounting a female naturally, that's pretty much the area that she would be getting stimulated. So Cindy's also feeling for the abdomen. You can see it would be her right hand kind of reaching down, feeling the abdomen. Sometimes we can even feel an egg, which is pretty cool. But she's also just getting a general idea, taking a pubic bone measurement, basically how far wide those pubic bones, and they change throughout the season. They have to get wider basically to make room for that egg to pass through. So just one of our detailed measurements that we take here. And then there's me on the right here doing the same thing, probably not as well as Cindy's doing. So one last step, the actual insemination. So this part, actually, you really only need 2 people with when you're doing females, because you have one person stroking, and I use the picture on the right here. It's kind of a side angle just to give a better idea of what the position actually looks like. So that's Kim Boardman, our curator on the right, and then Marianne Wilmington on the left. So we're actually inseminating. So basically, hopefully the female is responding while she's reverting her cloaca. We're putting the syringe in, and most of the time we're shooting for the oviduct. So as far as anatomy goes, the back end, the cloaca here is basically where everything happens, right? But within that, you have different chambers, we'll call it. So the oviduct is most of the time what we're trying to get that semen into. And that's just a direct shot up to fertilization, basically, versus in the wild, it would basically be a cloacal shot, as we call it, where the female does all the work. And sometimes we will do that, but most of the time we're trying to shoot for the oviduct. So basically, once Marianne puts it in, and you can't see it, honestly, maybe one time out of 99, 100 times, you might be able to, if the female is really into it, converting a cloaca, you can see. But for the most part, honestly, you really can't see anything. So a lot of it is really just experience, and Marianne is by far the best at it. I'm still learning a little bit. I've gotten better, but still not nearly as good as her. But basically, you're just going, and then it's all feel. You're kind of rolling the syringe lightly around, and then all of a sudden, it just might slip in another centimeter or so, and say, okay. So then the actual insemination occurs. The stroker will actually stop stroking, settle things down a little bit, and then that's it. And we actually leave this syringe there. We don't purposely pull it out after plunging it. A lot of times it's like a vacuum then. If you pulled it out, you would actually pull a lot of the sample out with it, which we do not want to do. So then we let the, after plunging it, just kind of let the female's body work. Then she'll kind of work the syringe out on her own. Sometimes I swear it seems like forever, but usually it's probably like 5 seconds. So that's the last step. Or is it? I hope, I'm terrible with technology. Gosh, I hope this works. But this is, I'm not gonna lie to you, this is a video I took just recently. It wasn't directly after artificial insemination, but this is exactly what we do. So basically, as positive reinforcement for our birds, after we come into their territory and work with them, we basically toss them treats at the end here. And as you can tell, and honestly, I think they get more excited than this particular pair of birds is here. So basically, it's just positive reinforcement, give them some smelt, let them let them enjoy that. A lot of times they'll unison call, like, you know, we leave their area, they unison call like they defended it. So, oh boy, I gotta figure out. Oh, sorry about that. So we're done with AI out in Crane City anyway. We do have a few more things to do, and that all happens back here in the building, in the lab. So basically what we're doing then is, even after inseminating the female, you know, we've inseminated, we've plunged the entire sample out of the syringe. There's always just a tiny little bit, just enough that we can put on a microscope slide and take a look at. And basically we're looking for two different things. We're looking for quantity, so just how many semen there are, and then locomotion. Are they moving? Are they moving well? Is this, you know, are they dead at that point? Why are they dead? So basically what we're looking at, and honestly, we grade it as far as quantity anyway, we grade it on an A through F. So A being the best, F being nothing. And within that, we actually, you know, A plus, A minus, B plus, through the line, just to give a general idea. A plus being, you know, you can hardly see. In this particular slide, it's really tough to get a picture, but you see a lot of, you know, the white background, nothing, and then the little blurry black things are basically semen. We're an A plus sample. You honestly probably couldn't even see any light in there. There'd be so many. Like I said, the other thing we're looking at is locomotion. So how well are they moving? And we want, you know, we get a general count of how many, you know, an A plus sample with a 95% motility is, you know, an excellent sample, obviously. So how well they're moving. And then from there, we can, you know, decide, you know, if that female happens to lay an egg here in, you know, any 3 to 5 days, we'll say, which is usually about prime timing. Is there a good chance that that egg will actually be fertile? So that's one thing we want to look at. And, you know, if we have an A plus sample with a 95% motility and that female lays an egg in 4 days, if that egg happens to not be fertile, why? Why not? I mean, there's absolutely no reason really at that point. So, and then, you know, I included dud or stud here. So it really is, you know, a lot of it, you know, it could be one day if they have an off day for whatever reason. But here's another slide showing the detailed records. And this really gives us a good idea through, you know, a longer period of time in general. You know, maybe a particular male started off great, giving great samples. Then through time, he's just slowly starting to fade. So then, you know, basically then at that point, you have to decide, does, you know, do we need to, you know, switch to a different donor? Stuff like that. So this is really detailed records come into, and this happens to be a female data sheet. Male data sheets look a lot, very much similar, if you will. There are a few different differences on here. So including, you know, the oviduct, which is really the insemination site. These are the eggs laid here, then the timing. So really it helps us to look back and say, okay, you know, this egg should be fertile without a doubt. Why isn't it, or why not? So, so the results are in, and boom, who doesn't like a cute fuzzy? This happens to be a sandhill crane chick picture. So really I should have included a picture as well. So basically what we'll do, artificial insemination, we get eggs. We'll actually incubate those eggs anywhere from roughly 7 to 10 days, just because at that point there's enough development within that egg that we can actually candle the egg, you know, in a low light situation and determine whether it's fertile or not. It's not that, you know, we do an artificial insemination and then we wait, you know, most eggs are roughly, you know, 28 to 30 days of incubation before hatching. We're not waiting that entire time without a clue that it was fertile or not. So we're actually, you know, we're candling those eggs. So we have, you know, within, and it unfortunately can't candle them right away. It takes, you know, usually a minimum of 7 days to determine fertility. Then we're looking for, you know, a developed air cell and such. But so yeah, from that point, you know, we can determine, do we need to switch donors? Do we need to try something else? Whatever it may be. So yeah, you basically come up with this awesome plan. That's awesome in my head anyway. And then I get through the season and it's, you know, I may just need to switch things around a little bit and switch donors and, you know, whatever it may be, or switch, you know, the staff members that are, you know, working with the birds, because some are very particular, we'll say, about who they like stroking them and such. Honestly, it's crazy. They're a lot like people. The cranes are, they're all individuals. Some are sassy, some are sweethearts, and everything in between. So yeah, it's just a very interesting thing. And I honestly, you know, growing up, I never thought I would be doing artificial insemination on anything, let alone an endangered whooping crane, which is just incredible. It's a great experience. I love it. Like I said, it's almost a friendly competition, we'll say, between my grandpa and I now, even though I know darn well I'll probably never artificially inseminate 100,000 birds, but darn it, I'm gonna try. So questions. Another pretty picture of a Parasaurus cranes with a little chick here.
Great, thanks Kyle for that great description and presentation on artificial insemination. We have a number of great questions out there from our viewers. So can you tell us a little bit more about how the genetic pairings are determined and some of the SSPs that ICF is involved with?
Yeah, Kim, you might honestly have a better answer as far as who the geneticist we work with now is. So Kim, our curator, she really goes through a lot of the initials. She gets all the pairings for me, basically through the SSP and stuff. And then I just take that work and I basically have the easy part, I think, at that point. But yeah, it's nothing that I personally do. Like I said, it's honestly way over my head. A lot of that stuff. So I don't care if you have honestly have a better answer for that than I do.
Sure.
Sorry to put the pressure on you.
No, we do work with a lot of the species survival plans. I think 11 of the 15 species or 9 of the 15 species have managed captive population programs. And so each of those programs has their own population biologist that works specifically with that that captive population across the Association of Zoos and Aquarium Institutions, and looks at the relatedness. So tries to make recommendations to breed, the least least related individuals with each other, as well as kind of the least represented individuals with the least represented individuals, versus breeding really rare genetics with really common genetics. So we try to look at that as well. And so they have all of their own special software program that we can import the birds' pedigrees and genetic information into that can help with making those recommendations for us. So. A couple of questions for you, Kyle, about the different species. And so for some of the, like the Southern Hemisphere species, how does their breeding seasonality in the wild, which is opposite of North American species, how does that affect egg laying and kind of the timing of egg laying in captivity? Do we see changes between species seasonality?
Oh yeah, definitely. You know, here in North America, you know, we have whooping cranes and sandhills, and you know, our birds in captivity are laying at the same time as, you know, sandhills and whooping cranes in the wild here. And kind of, you know, going back to that slide I had earlier, there is quite a vast difference from, you know, the wattle cranes that we have. You know, they're, you know, building nests and laying eggs sometimes in February here, whereas Saurus cranes are, you know, they're building and laying eggs June usually is, you know, earlier, sometimes July even. And then basically you have everything in between. Then we have our, you know, our black crown cranes and our gray crown cranes. They're a little harder for me anyway to pinpoint a specific time that they're laying. They seem to be a lot more random, if you will. So really, yeah, there is, I kind of like it, honestly, how the season is drawn out, if you will, how it's longer than just a mad sprint for 2 months. It's more of a marathon, because then, you know, I enjoy doing this part of my work. So, you know, it gets drawn out, it gets extended, if you will. So I honestly like that there are differences in the timing, you know, anywhere from February to, good Lord, through the entire year, honestly, sometimes, depending on what specific birds we're working with regards to SSPs and stuff like that.
Are you freezing any semen from males right now?
No, not currently right now, but that, you know, I think I talked a little bit about that, where the last few years, well, not this last year with COVID, but years prior to that, we've had a few individuals from other institutions actually come work with us, and they're basically working on methods to freeze semen. And then, you know, the thawing process is really, from my understanding, is the tough part with cranes anyway, sometimes, is getting those semen from, you know, being frozen to being viable after thawing out. So that's one thing, I didn't think I mentioned it earlier, that we're actually looking, and from my understanding as well, ICF used to do quite a bit more of this. But basically what we're trying to do now, we just discussed it recently actually, is getting back into it and trying to find the best methods to make, you know, it as viable as we possibly can. So yeah, it's something new to me personally. So I'm actually really looking forward to it. I think everyone in our department is, honestly. So yeah, it should be interesting and a fun, I don't want to say experiment, but since we do have a pretty good background on it with other individuals that have worked with it, and utilizing ICF's methods from back in the day to basically incorporate and try and get the best possible method into one.
Great. There are a lot of questions coming in. We'll try to take a few more, but we might have to answer some offline. Okay. There's a lot of great questions out here. Next one for you, Kyle, is do fecal or urate contaminations during the collection pose a problem for the samples?
Absolutely. So we have certain individuals, and I won't call any of our birds out, but we have certain individuals that tend to give very contaminated samples, whether it is with, you know, feces, urates, whatever it may be. And it can affect both the life of the semen itself, so how long those will stay alive, and also it really affects what we do with that sample, depending on how bad it is. A lot of times if we get a very, you know, contaminated sample or somewhat contaminated sample with feces or urates, we'll actually still use it, but a lot of times we'll actually give that sample to a female and just give her a cloacal insemination. So basically then what we're letting happen is her body go through the filtering process as it would in the wild, where she's actually, instead of inseminating right up into her oviduct, we're just putting in the cloaca and then basically letting her body take over and do the natural thing that it does. Because, you know, it happens in the wild as well. So we're letting, you know, her figure out what's good and what's bad at that point. But yeah, it can affect the life of the semen as well. So.
Great. Another question, great question out there. When you're doing the pelvic check on the females and you feel an egg before AI, does that alter your AI plans for that bird?
Yes and no. Sometimes it does. It really depends on where the egg is. We might opt, even though we collected from, you know, a male for this particular female, we might opt to save that sample and actually do an insemination just right after she were to lay the egg. Or, you know, most likely we'd probably just to make sure we have the freshest sample possible, we'll just disregard that sample we collected and go collect a new one as soon and use it, you know. Sometimes depending on, a lot of times you can feel like how far along the egg is. A lot of times we will give the insemination as long as when you put the syringe in, you're literally not hitting the egg. It doesn't happen very often, but sometimes, you know, that thing is so close to coming out that, you know, the last thing you want to do is put the syringe in and accidentally damage the egg or anything like that. So yeah, it really is a case-to-case basis sometimes, but.
One of our viewers asked, how many eggs do you get per female and how many inseminations does that require?
Oh boy. Again, it really varies, not only from female to female, but from year to year. So with, especially with whooping cranes, we're doing a lot of multiple clutching. So we're trying to get, you know, several eggs out of the female in a given year without pushing them too far. Basically, we're not trying to, you know, deplete their system. And we've never had an issue. We've done, you know, eggshell thickness in the past, stuff like that, when giving them added calcium. But, you know, on average, depending on the female, we may, you know, may get six eggs from an individual whooping crane, and that period of time might last, you know, a good month to 6 weeks, something like that. And each bird is a little different as far as their clutching pattern. So with most birds anyway, you know, they'll lay a two egg clutch. So they'll lay their first egg, and then, you know, 2 to 3 to 4 days later, they'll lay their second egg. And then, you know, a lot of times we're pulling those, because if we did not pull those eggs, they would end up incubating and sitting on them. And then usually, and this is all averages really, just a general, usually 10 to 14 days later is when they'll actually lay their third, fourth egg then. So it really varies. And every year is different, like I said earlier, as far as how many eggs we're trying to get. It depends on a lot of factors. Are only a couple of our female birds producing? Or, you know, all of a sudden we're getting a bunch of birds producing eggs, so we don't need as many from a particular female. But yeah, it can, you know, an AI season for a particular bird, you know, if it goes a month to 6 weeks, it's not very uncommon. So
this is a similar question. It's a nice follow-up, and I think it might, we'll see, it might be our last question for the webinar today, but do females retain sperm for delayed fertilization like some other mammals do, reptiles and mammals? And do they lay eggs seasonally regardless of whether they've been fertilized or not?
So yes, as far as we know anyway, and you know, others probably have more information than I do on this, but there have been, you know, studies done that have shown that, you know, some cranes have been able to store semen, I think I want to say up to like 10 days. So it's incredibly interesting to me how they can do that and how basically they can keep that sperm that entire time viable, so that, you know, when it comes time for fertilization, that sperm is still ready to go. And then, sorry, what was the second part of that, Kim?
Yeah. Do females lay eggs seasonally regardless of whether or not they've been fertilized?
Yes, for the most part anyway. You know, we have some individual females out in Crane City that aren't paired for whatever reason it may be, you know, imprinted birds, whatever it is, that they'll lay eggs without being fertilized or inseminated or anything. And that, you know, a lot of it depends too on, you know, is a bird paired with a male, even though, you know, we aren't doing artificial insemination on every single bird we have by any means. But yeah, they'll still lay eggs on their own, and individuals will lay eggs on their own. And some birds that, you know, they won't lay an egg in a particular given year if they've lost their mate or whatever it may be. So it's more that, not necessarily the fertilization aspect, it's more the bond with, you know, their mate or sometimes honestly imprinted birds with us. So that's, yeah, it's, we get a lot of eggs in a year, even though we aren't necessarily fertilizing all of them.
And I think we actually do have time for one last question. Does ICF ever get semen from birds at different facilities? Or do we
send
ours to different facilities?
Yes, we've actually done that a little more the last few years. Where, you know, if our particular institution or facility has a male that's, you know, genetically valuable to a female that we have, they'll actually, you know, they can collect from them. And basically, honestly, we'll, you know, pack it up and overnight it FedEx style, keep the sample cool with, you know, ice packs and this and that. But yeah, we'll do the vice versa too, where we'll actually collect samples here sometimes and overnight them to a different facility. So it does happen. A lot of times, just for the ease of things, that's more of a long-term solution, is actually trying to get those birds together at the same facility. If it's, especially if it's a incredibly genetically valuable combination, because it down the road, it makes things just a lot easier for us. Versus overnighting samples all the time. So that's kind of a short-term solution to what hopefully will be a long-term fix.
Great. Thank you, Kyle. I think there are a lot of other great questions out there, but we will work on answering those for everybody offline.
Awesome. All right. Just a few more things for me here. Again, you know, I'd just like to thank our From the Field sponsor, who shall remain anonymous. Truly, we couldn't do this without you guys, and is much, much appreciated. And then, like I said earlier, if any of you guys are looking to possibly sponsor someone, you can contact Kate Fitzwilliams. Number is here, or kate@savingcranes.org. And then, drum roll. So the next From the Field webinar will be Thursday, March 18th at 11 a.m. Central Time. And this will be with the one and only Ann Lacey. So you guys do not want to miss this one. So Cranes 365, Glorious Gatherings of Cranes. And it's sponsored by Sandy and Dave Whitmore in honor of Ann's work at the International Crane Foundation. So then, you know, just a personal shout out for me for, you know, not only this webinar, but in general, your guys' support. You know, we could not do what we do without, you know, people like you. You know, if you're not a member, I strongly encourage you to become one, especially now with our new visitor area opening up. I think people are going to be absolutely amazed at how beautiful it is. I may be biased, but I honestly think it'll be a great experience. And, you know, we truly couldn't do what we do without you guys. So. A deep thank you.